Thank you for lifting us up with your love.
Amen.
Thank you for showing up in different circumstances. Thank you, Heavenly Father, Lord, for being there. Lord, even as we come into your presence, let our hearts be prepared to receive you. Let your word be understood. Let your word help us to become more for you, to become more for our neighborhoods, to become more for our nations. Thank you, Heavenly Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Let's put our hands together for you. The divine nature. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. 2 Peter chapter 1 verse 4. The summary of that chapter is very simple. It says, when we fully interact with the promises of God, we become part of God's agenda. When we are fully engaged with the promises that God gives us, we become part of his agenda. We partake of his divine nature. But that passage ends with some facts. It says that for you to be fully engaged and not be carried around, you must escape the corruption that comes from the world. The essence of this corruption is to limit our ability to partake in God's plan. That's the goal. We call them frictional forces that act against our motion. They are always there, either you recognize them or not. As you move, there's a force that is working against your fluent movement. And we looked at three of those corruptions last week. For those of you who are not here, let me just quickly catch you up. The first major corruption is our mind. Our mind is so much the biggest part of our corruption. The way we think, the way we perceive things, the things that the devil has dropped in our hearts against people and against God. It affects the way we are motivated to do things, the way we act, and the way we behave. When you don't have a confirmed understanding of God's character, when God presents himself to you in some ways, you will think he's not a consistent God. But if you're going to overcome your thoughts, you must come to a conclusion. So that the enemy does not manipulate your heart to doubt the consistency of God, you must come to a conclusion that God is what? No. God bless you. Somebody's awake. God is always good. Everybody is good sometimes. What did I say? Everybody is good sometimes. They may not be good to you, they are good to somebody else. But God is what? Always good. And that sometimes you may not fully understand it, God always has a plan. And the second corruption occurs when the devil tries to distract us. For every promise of God, there's a reason, there's a full image. That's what the Bible says in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1. But there's also a shadow. Something that looks like the real thing. And the essence, the reason why the devil brings the shadow is for us to leave the real thing and start to focus on the shadow. The real plan of God for Joseph was that Joseph would deliver the children of Israel from bondage to the house of Jacob. He will also make Egypt a great nation. For him to do that, he had to become a king. And because he was meant to be a king, Joseph was favored from a very young age. When his brothers were wearing rags, the father put all his money together and bought him a coat of many colors. He separated him. He made him look favored than everybody else. And quickly it went into Joseph's head that there's something different about him. So when God presented his promise to him in a dream, what Joseph saw was not the fact that he was a tool in God's hands to become a king. No, he saw himself as being superior to his brothers. And the first time he saw the dream, he said, "You are going to all bow down before me." And then he went to his father, he said, "The moon and the star also bow down before me," which means that you two are going to bow down before me. And God knew quickly that if he doesn't do something about Joseph, Joseph will go astray. So God stripped him, everyone say stripped. God stripped him of his coat of many colors and brought him into a pit to start all over again. The shadow is always there to distract you. If God says, "I promise you are going to have $1 million," the first thing to think about is not a comma. I don't know if they still make them. But the first thing you're not supposed to think about is a car. It's not for you, it's for God. You're just a vessel, a tool. Amen? Amen? And the third corruption is sin. We said in 2 Corinthians 7 verse 1 that when you receive that promise, you must make a conscious effort to walk away from sin. Not because it is easy, but you must decide in your heart that since this promise, you will cleanse yourself from all filthiness intentionally. You will make a decision like Job did in Job chapter 31 verse 1 and said, "Me, you are my eyes, let's have an agreement, we will never look at any woman." He made up his mind before the circumstances came, and that is what you must do. Amen?
Amen.
So, today, God only gives a promise because he has a plan. That's the first thing you must understand. The reason why God gives a promise is because there's so many reasons. But one of the most important reasons is that he doesn't want you to think that halfway through the process, things are just happening. He wants you to know that it was intentional what he's saying. When God has a dream with anybody, he tells them what their relationship is from the beginning. Amen? He doesn't change the terms of agreement or the terms of contract. God makes a promise so that you will know that he has a plan. And he gives you a promise because he wants you to participate. Everybody say participate. Participate in his agenda. If I walk to my sister now and I say, "I intend to do something," the only reason why I'm telling her is because I want her to be a part of my agenda. So when God comes to you, it's because he has a plan and he wants you to be a part of that plan. That is why he gives you a promise. When you act, when you start to participate in God's plan, you start to partake of what? Of his divine nature. You start to partake of his plan, of what he intends to do. Let's take for example, God had an agenda. He had a plan in Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. He had an agenda, and he looked around for someone to use, and he found a man called Abraham. He was not called Abraham at that time, he was called Abraham. He found a man called Abraham, the son of Terah, but he was an idol worshiper. You'll be wondering why would God leave anybody else and go to an idol worshiper to discuss his plans with? Why Abraham? Two reasons I spotted when I was reading the Bible. I spotted two reasons very clearly. Number one, Abraham was empty. Abraham had no... He was available for God to fill. And that's why most of the time when I see people come from other faith into our faith, they do more than we have ever done. If you see a converted Muslim become a Christian, you will see the energy with which they will know they are God. Because they came what? Empty. Abraham was an idol worshiper. He was empty. He had space to be filled. One day Jesus Christ was talking to the Pharisees. And they had misbehaved. They had done so many things that made them feel that they knew too much. And Jesus Christ said to them, because he had just opened the eyes of a blind man, and he was wondering, let's go to John chapter 9, verse 39. He said to them, "For judgment I have come into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see may be made blind." When you are already full, there's nothing to be added to you. It's difficult for God to work with such people. Amen?
Amen.
And the Pharisees, with their little understanding, in verse 40 said, "Are you saying we are blind?" And Jesus Christ said to them in verse 41, he said, it would have been better if you were blind. He said, if you were blind, you would have no sin. But now you say, we see. Therefore, your sin remains. It's only those who are empty that are useful to God. And that was one of the reasons I felt God decided to choose Abraham. Number two reason why God decided to choose Abraham, from what I study, and you may see more as you study your word, was that I noticed that Abraham had a problem. He had a problem that required him to meet God by faith. The Bible says in Genesis 11 verse 30, before God came to him, that Abraham was married to a very pretty woman, but the woman was what? Barren. It wasn't that she became barren, she was barren. She had no child. Abraham married a barren woman. So God had seen this man that was completely empty, that has a need for God, that has a problem that will require faith for him to overcome. So God came to him. Amen? I want to note this, church. If you don't have a need for God, he will not call you to participate in his divine agenda. He will not. The reason why the Western world today is getting less and less into God is because they don't need God. You know, we have to pray for everything. The training, when you meet God, you pray for everything. If your car is stolen, they'll give you another one, you are insured. If your house burns down, they'll give you another one. If your kidney fails, they'll replace it. Who needs God? And when you cease to meet God, God does not have anything he can bargain with when he comes to you. You are self-sufficient. What can God offer you? So how can God take from you when he has nothing to offer you? You don't need faith. You don't need to rely on anybody. You don't need any help. You are all by yourself. You are fully confident, well packaged, fully loaded. So God does not bother to come to such people. This tells me why God came to Abraham. So God gave Abraham the promise, Genesis chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. He said to him, "You man that is empty, you man that is a problem." Says, "Now the Lord said to Abraham, get out of your country, from your family and from your father's house, to a land that I will show you." Now the Lord, he says, "I will make you a great nation." The first thing is that God gives you an instruction. And then he gives you what you are bound to receive. It's always a negotiation. "I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great. And you shall be a blessing." Now, to a man who knows that he has married a woman without womb, He knows that he has to hang with this God, yes or no? But to a man who already has 15 children, who believe that there's a law of multiplication that 15 will give back to 30 or 45, and 45, you already know who I need, where I need you for. I can produce the nation myself. But there was a problem. Even though this man was in line with God, he was not fully persuaded by that promise. Amen? So God came again in Genesis 17 and spoke specifically to his problem. In the name of Jesus, God will come to you.
Amen.
And he will speak specifically to your situation.
Amen.
When God came back to Abraham, now he was called Abraham, in Genesis 17, he came and spoke concerning Sarah directly. Genesis 17 verse 16. He said, I know your problem, boy. I know your problem. He said, I will bless her. And also give you a son by her. Then I will bless her again. And she shall be a mother of not one person, but a mother of nations. That's it. It is the way you connect. As an evidence. If I preach a word, and as I'm speaking, there's a word that connects to you, and you say, I claim it, so a seed to seal it. Look, in the parable of the sower, just Christ said something. He said, the seer does not sow seed, he sows the word. Right? When he was explaining the parable, what did he say? He said, the seer sowed what? The word. So when you sow your seed, you are confessing. What did I say? Your seed is a form of evidence through confession. Hebrews 11 chapter 4, Hebrews 11 verse 4 tells us about that beautiful guy called Abel. The Bible says that Abel offered to God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained witness that he was what? Righteous. He obtained his witness through his seed. And God testified of his gift, and through it, he, being dead, still speaks. After Abel was dead, his seed was still speaking. That's what I'm saying. So we see, it's the one area that we have missed it as Christians. The area of sacrifice. For what we want to give nothing for it. But if you truly believe God, come up with an evidence. It's an evidence of things hoped for. Let me close. And I'll continue from here next time. How do you know that the promise has started? How do you know? How do you know, church? When you know that you are beginning to walk into the promise. How did Abraham know that Isaac is going to come? How do you know that your promise has started? Everything goes back. When your promise begins to manifest, it suddenly looks as if everything is failing. It's like the world is coming down on you. Have you noticed that every time you make a serious decision for God, everything just goes down? You know why? You know why, church? It's because God begins every new day with an evening. Genesis chapter 1 verse 5. Every God's new day does not start in the morning, it starts in the evening. The Bible says, God called the light day and the darkness he called night. So the evening and the morning were the first day. When God wants to start with you, he starts with you when it's dark. He starts in the evening. For your son to shine. It was God sent. That is how God defines his day. For instance, today if you take a step of faith and you truly, truly decide that Jesus Christ will be your Lord and Savior, if you totally accept him and give up everything else, everything will suddenly go dark. Your friends may leave you. Your business may go down first. Because now you can't cheat anymore, you can't bribe anymore. The moment you truly decide for God, it may look bleak, but I want you to start rejoicing. Because weeping may endure for a night. Joy comes in the morning. Everyone that has night is stepping into a new day. Let us bow our heads. Are you here this morning? You are going to take a step of faith. Yes, I'm not lying to you. It may be dark for a while. But you should rejoice. Because it just got better. You should rejoice because you are now partaking of a promise. You should rejoice because your nature is being transformed. The surgery has begun. The pain will make you better. The pain will make you whole. The pain will change your story. Are you here this morning? You want to take that step of faith? I want you to come to the altar this morning. I don't want anybody to sit down if you are deciding for Christ. Just come to me. Come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because the step of faith is a conviction that is real. It is not something that is just an ephemeral, a thought of the mind. No, it's a step of faith. You must walk towards what you hope for. If you hope to be in heaven someday, take a step of faith this morning. I come to this altar and kneel down and just cry to God. Just tell God what is on your heart. Tell God that you need his help. Tell God that you need him to transform you, that you are ready for him. If you are coming, just come now. Just come to the altar now if you are coming. Just come and say to him, Lord, I am tired. I've tried it my way. I need you. I truly need you. I genuinely need you. Come into my life this morning. As I take this step of faith, yes, I know the consequences, but I know that the end is going to be better than the beginning. And there's the fullness of joy yet. Are you coming this morning? Just come. Just come to the altar of God. Just come. If you want to come, don't let anybody stop you. They're not coming to meet man, they're coming to meet with God. And if you take that step of faith, it is between you and God. It is your own life. It is your decision. You will see that, yes, the true birth is the real birth. Not because you have been around for so long. No, it is the one day that you truly commit to him that makes the difference in your life. It's not about who you are. Yes, even great men of God that have served God for 30, 40 years will realize that they have not come to the fullness of his knowledge. And if they will humble themselves, they will come and say, Lord, I need you. I need you. As you come today, I'll wait another 30 seconds. Because God wants you to take, it's a step of faith. You are walking towards your destiny. After today, you can never be the same because you came out physically to meet with me. You came out to give your life. If you are coming, please run. If you are coming from upstairs, come quickly. Another 15 seconds, I will pray. If you are coming, just come. Come, I wait another 10 seconds. Yes, come. He is waiting for you because you are making a decision. It's a personal decision. But you are doing it this way because you know that it is the last time you will ever do it. Because yes, you are doing it for total commitment to the kingdom. Lord, we thank you for this place. Some took a long walk from upstairs to come. Some came because their hearts touched them of pride. Some came, Lord Almighty, because they have come to a stage of hopelessness and they want to receive hope. Doesn't matter how you come. Talk to God this morning. and say, Lord, I have come to you. Because I know that if I did not take this step of faith this morning, I could never be made whole. As I have taken the step of faith, I have walked towards my destiny. Solidify my life in you. Lord, let me never wander away from you again. Take away my sins. Take away my shortcomings. Every area of my life, the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Every area that I have come short, have mercy. Let my life be a joy to you. Thank you, Heavenly. Lord, I pray for this one particularly. I say, Lord, in your infinite mercies, deal with them like no one. Let these ones become pillars in your house. Let these ones, Lord Almighty, walk tirelessly for you. Let these ones find grace to remain faithful. Lord, let your blood flow ahead of them on a daily basis. Cleanse them of all unrighteousness. And know that you have finished the work, even on the cross. Lord, I thank you because of this cross. Everything that troubled them in the past will trouble them before. Lord, these ones are brand new. They're brand new. They're brand new. They are taking a step of faith. Let them overcome by faith. Even as all heads are still bowed, all eyes are still closed, you can go back to your seat. While you are bowing your head, just ask God for the grace to. He that standeth, let him be cautious, lest he falls. Ask that God Almighty will keep you faithful. And that you will mix faith with his promises, even in the course of this week, so that you can do more for him. So shall it be. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen.